Thank you. That was Cloud, and we really appreciate all those talents. I imagine you as one of those one-man bands, you know. That was excellent. Thank you so much. Good morning. I'd like to welcome all of you here this morning, those of you that are online and those of you that are in person. This is our 4th of July celebration. It's always kind of hard to figure out where to put that when you have it in the middle of the week, so we chose this day. And I hope that all of you realize that in light of the great ends of the church, which I will be preaching about for the next few weeks, today we're doing preservation of the truth. The words from John 14, Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." As we worship in praise and truth, we know the Son and the lessons for life that Jesus taught us, and that's kind of what we'll be talking about today. We believe that everyone needs a church home, and I hope that if you are a visitor with us, you'll make your presence known either to someone sitting around you or to me when I get into the narthex. We would love to know that you're with us and answer any questions you might have. Also, today is our last table, and I don't know exactly how to tell you what she's having, because she's having a kind of a smorgasbord of all your favorite meals, like chicken nuggets and chicken sandwich and cheeseburger and lasagna. I mean, the whole nine yards. So this is our last one. I hope that you will try to make every effort to be there. And then a little later in the service, we will be recognizing Connie for all that she's done for us, because that was really, she took this and ran with it in the very beginning, and it's been a blessing to us. Also, VBS signups, there are things that you can still help with, ways that you can participate. It's July 22nd through 26th from 9 to 12. And just let Teresa know if you have any questions or if there's something that you'd like to help with or if there's something you'd like to bring. She's kind of the knower of all of that. So please let her know if you can do something. Now please stand and join together in hymn 262, "God of the Ages, Whose Almighty Hand."
Thank you. Why are we here?
Why is there something instead of nothing?
Who made all this?
Where did it come from?
Where did it come from?
What does the Bible say?
What does the Bible say?
What do I believe?
Belief is when you know something is true.
If you can see something with your eyes, like a person, place, or thing, then it's easy to believe that it's there. You can feel it with your hands. You can describe it to someone else, and they can believe in it too.
But what about something you can't see with your eyes or touch with your hands? Things like happiness, anger, or love.
Those things are still real, and even though we can't really see them, we still believe they exist.
And even though we can't touch them, they're still really powerful.
Belief is really powerful too. When you believe in something, it's more than just knowing or feeling it.
Belief will change your actions and the way you make choices.
In fact, your beliefs can change your whole life.
The Bible tells us a lot about God, that He made us, loves us, and sent Jesus for us.
And believing in Jesus is a big deal.
Even if you can't see Jesus physically, you can believe in Him.
And that belief can change your whole life too.
Now, belief doesn't mean you never have any questions. In fact, you might have a ton of questions about the Bible, God, or Jesus.
That's totally cool.
God gave us brains so we could use them to think, ask questions, and learn.
When we choose to believe even when we have questions, that's called faith.
The Bible says, faith is being sure of what we hope for.
It is being sure of what we do not see.
Another way of saying this is, faith is when we believe something even if we have questions.
And whatever big questions you have, God can handle it. He's powerful. He's good, and He wants to hear from you.
Sunday school is starting. Children are invited to join their Sunday school teachers in the back for Children's Sunday School in Grace Place. See you soon!
Good morning, church family. It's Independence. We'll be recognizing Independence Day, 4th of July. That's our freedom. Our Lord and Savior also gave us freedom, and that's what we're worshiping today. When He gave His life, He gave us resurrection power. Once we accepted Him into our hearts, He promised us. He made a promise to us that though you may die, You shall live forever in heaven with him, as long as you believe in Jesus Christ our Lord and put your faith in him. The name of this song is Resurrection Powers by Ed Cash and Ryan Elite, and it speaks to that. You called me from the grave by name. You called me out and all my shame. I see the old has passed away, the new has come. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom, no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I'm dressed in your royalty. Your Holy Spirit lives in me. I see my past has been redeemed. The new has come. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom, no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I'm dressed in your royalty. Your Holy Spirit lives in me. I see my past has been redeemed. The new has come. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom, no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom, freedom. You have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom. You have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. Hallelujah. Freedom. You have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. Our chains are gone. Freedom. You have given us freedom. Freedom, hallelujah. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. Living on the inside, Jesus. No longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom.
working hard.
This mission trip to the Valley was a truly eye-opening experience. Whether it be serving families in the respite center, organizing clothes, moving and organizing boxes, cleaning for border missions, or preparing food for asylumees, everyone had experiences to take back with them. Jesus' light was on full display in the grace and hard work of our youth and adult chaperones. Thank you for everyone who participated and supported this event.
I had spoken to Mary Megan, and she said that they had a great time and did a lot of hard work. It was really hot, as you can imagine. Let us go to God in prayer. Creator, sustainer, and redeemer God, we come before you this morning with full hearts. Our joys and sorrows are all mixed up together. We rejoice in the beauty and miracle and majesty of creation. We rejoice in the simple pleasures of summer's rhythms. We rejoice in the community of faith, in the love we have for one another, in the service we provide to our neighbors, and in the faith we express in you, God. Alongside all this rejoicing, we grieve too. We lift up in prayer those for whom this week has brought hurt or worry, those who've had disappointment, hurt, loss, or that are lonely. We pray for the victims of natural disasters and famine and war and violence. We pray for those whose work brings them into harm's way. Emergency personnel, soldiers, mediators. We pray for those who seek in the face of those who seek peace in the face of overwhelming hate. And we pray for those who need our love the most and ask you to bring them to us. We're grateful, God, for the privileges we have in this country, for the freedom to vote and to worship, for access to education and medical care. Help us to remember that a privilege is not a blessing until it's shared. And help us to bless our country and to bless each other. We pray for those who live under persecution from their governments, who suffer from limited resources and blatant corruption. And God, we pray for those who are sick today, who need your healing touch. We pray especially for those suffering illnesses for which there is no cure. Help them to find hope in the day-to-day of their life. Risen Lord, we remember with joy and with sorrow those who have died. We admit freely that we grieve, missing those whom we loved, wanting their presence in our lives. Yet we also confess that we rejoice, knowing that they are with you, and grateful for their example in our lives. We remember the string of witnesses who have brought us to this place, the faithful of the ages who have served you and built up your church. We rejoice that one day we shall join them in forever singing to the glory of your name. We pray especially this day for the men and women who have died or been injured defending the lives we so happily enjoy. Especially, we're grateful for those who have died defending the freedoms that this country was founded on. They do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. We bring these and all other prayers in our hearts to you, O God, giving infinite thanks for the gift of prayer, for the fact that you listen when we cry and when we sing, that you abide with us every day of our lives. We give thanks for the simple prayer that Christ taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Okay, we all feel very patriotic now, right? That was great. Thank you. The great end of the church that we'll be talking about today is the preservation of the truth. That's the truth of the Bible. And as I mentioned during the summer, I'm going to be speaking about what we believe as PCUSA congregations. I will be proclaiming, sheltering, nurturing, maintaining, and today, preserving. I think the truth is really a great place to start. Now listen for these words from John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God and believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and you have seen him. And then from Isaiah 45. For thus says the Lord who created the heavens, he is God, who formed the earth and made it, established it. He did not create it a chaos. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I did not speak in secret in a land of darkness. I did not say to the offspring of Jacob, seek me in chaos. I, the Lord, speak the truth, and I declare what is right. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. So we can be in the same place and see the same things, but because of our perspective, the truth and interpretation of a situation might be different. It is that dreaded statement, both things can be true at the same time. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson were on a camping trip. As they lay down for the night, Holmes said, Watson, look up at the sky and tell me what you see. Watson looked up and he said, I see millions and millions of stars. Holmes said, so what does that tell you? Oh, Watson, being very thoughtful, answered, astronomically, it tells me that there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets. Theologically, it tells me that God is great and that we are small and insignificant. Meteorologically, it tells me that we have a beautiful day tomorrow. What does it tell you, Holmes? Always the practical one, he said, it tells me that someone stole our tent. Both things can be true at the same time. Ask my friends and my family, and they will tell you for a long time my mantra has been, the truth is always somewhere in the middle. For many, that's a very scary thought. In this time of taking side and assigning blames to those who are not in agreement with us, whether it's politics, religion, or even sports teams, as much as we hate to admit it, the truth is usually somewhere in the middle. In our society today, we have come to be more and more polarized and less accepting of our brothers and sisters. The truth seems to be more elusive than ever. We don't want to think about perspective and interpretation. We want the truth to be the truth, our truth. We live in a time people only accept one answer to a problem. Yet in our world, it seems that absolutes are no longer applicable. For instance, in today's news, we're bombarded with so much, and finding the truth is almost impossible. It's usually dependent on where we get our news. There is the evening news blaming Israel, Palestine, Hamas, or for whatever in the Middle East problems. And often it's complete disagreement in who to blame, who's sparking the conflict and its horrible problems. Then there are diets, low carb, low sugar, Weight Watchers, keto, so many. I recently read instructions on one of the diet pill crazes. Take this pill before eating. Along with eating sensibly and daily exercise, you can expect to have a weight loss of 2 pounds a week. Really, eating sensibly and daily exercise. I venture to say if we did that, the weight loss would happen without the pills, but that's just me. It's a matter of perspective and interpretation. What is truth? People today are looking for a sure answer, something they can count on, something they can hold on to, something they can believe in. Public opinion, television news, Facebook, the internet. We can't seem to get a firm footing in all of this. We yearn for the truth, a truth in which we can place our confidence and trust, a truth that we're sure of. What can we count on? Well, as Christians, thankfully, we believe there is something we can count on, something worthy of our confidence and belief. It's the Bible. God's own word to humanity, God's word of truth for believers. A number of years ago, a candidate for the moderator of the General Assembly was asked, "What do you believe are the causes of the conflict in the PCUSA, and what do you hope this General Assembly will help do to bring a resolution?" His reply speaks to the truth of the Bible and the conflict we have in today's world. He said, "Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Yet many in the Presbyterian Church persist on beginning with the abstract notions of truth. The right insists on the old truth, linking a desire for certitude and tradition. The left favors new truth, advocating for progress and freedom from constraints. But the way mattered to Jesus. For Jesus, neither indulging in the fetish of traditionalism or the novelty of the left was the answer. Only equal faithfulness to the way and truth leads to the fullness of life." And that's not an easy thing to come up with. That's not an easy thing for us to ascertain, but it is a call for us. Scriptures carry an authority that we cannot find in any other place. In today's world, I feel there's a crisis of truth. Truth and whose word is credible. Unlike Jesus when he was questioned by Pilate in this postmodern world, we would have a question to pose to Pilate when he asked, "What is truth?" We might want to say, "Whose truth?" We've begun to say not "what is truth," but rather, "What is true for me?" In our turbulent world, this puts us on a very slippery slope. We might feel secure with the question, but that is because we assume our answer is the only right answer. And if we argue long enough and hard enough that we're right, eventually, everybody will agree with us. It'll become the reality. Unfortunately, that's not the case. Every day, we see the issues getting further and further polarizing. The truth becomes relative to the reality of the individual. That is what produces chaos. As Christians, our source of truth is the revelation found in Scripture. Revelation is a truth that comes to us from outside of creation, outside of science, outside of feelings, even cultural norms. For Christians, the Bible serves as the revelation of objective truth from the one who is beyond scientific verification and who's not bound by cultural norms or, worse yet, subjective feelings. God's truth is freely given to us in Jesus Christ, who is the one who dwells among us, full of grace and truth, the one who came to bear witness to the truth, and the one who promises the Spirit of truth, the one who is the truth. And I realize that the Bible was written over a period of 1,600 years in different parts of the world and in different languages, but that complicated fact is also the beauty of it. By inspiring the writers of Scripture, the Holy Spirit did not suppress the personality and style of the authors. Rather, the Holy Spirit worked through the particular historical setting, education, and personality of each author in communicating God's word to them. That's actually what makes us study Scripture, not just listen to it and memorize it, but study it and think about the historical setting, the people of their time, and the personality of the author. It's written by human hands, but inspired by God. God's word in human words. That means that often there's important truths in many areas of Scripture, but if ever they contradict the words of Christ, then we need to revisit the words and our interpretation of them. And I think that's one of the things that we see a lot in some churches, is that they talk about exactly what the scripture says and they fail to take into consideration that some things are totally against what Christ taught us. When that happens, I always say, go back to Christ. Those are the words that are infallible. Our society now more than ever needs a true word that can be trusted to answer the ultimate questions of who am I? Why am I here and where am I going? To us, the Bible alone offers authoritative answers and provides the truth that we so desperately seek. So the fivefold activity of Scripture is make one wise to salvation, teach us, rebuke us, correct us, and train us in righteousness. For Scripture to do these things, we must read it often and thoroughly and think about it. Not take it on the surface, think about it. If we desire to be changed in the process of studying Scripture, we have to apply the words to our lives. By faith, we affirm the truth of Scripture, and then it is the study of the Word of God that our lives are transformed. It's not something that you do on the surface. It's something you do in your heart. It's something you do with your mind. Years ago, Karl Barth, a very famous biblical scholar, was giving lectures in our country. He was from Germany. He was asked, "What is the most profound insight that's been revealed to you in your many years of biblical scholarship and study?" Thought for a moment, and then he leaned in, and he said, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." Simple, yes, but it embraced the simple idea, and when we do that, it becomes life-changing. I would pray that we develop a passion for the truth of the Word of God. When we say that one of the great ends of the church is the preservation of divine truth, we mean all of us struggling and engaging in this activity will strengthen us as people and as a church. It means that you and I will be diligent in teaching and reading and encouraging each other as we are the church. Doing this, we will be equipping the children of God to live in a world that often pushes up against what we know to be truth. Over the years, especially as a female pastor, many have quoted scripture to me to prove some point, especially the words of the Apostle Paul. My feeling is that anything that's a centerpiece for scripture is what was said by Christ. All the rest is to support his words. So that for the ultimate truth is the words of Christ. He is the truth. I have a way of looking at scripture that is, I would say, not always welcomed by some of our literalists. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. To me, that means that Jesus reveals to us in his words and actions the truth of life. Feed the hungry. Reach out to the marginalized. Love thy neighbor. That's what Jesus teaches us. That's the truth. That's the way to live our lives. If we are only able to read a few books of the Bible, I pray that it's the Gospels. Maybe we have become too accepting of other people's truth to the point of losing our own. Think about that for yourselves. Have you become so accepting of other people's truth that you've lost your own? We need to start there and then make political, social, and cultural decisions as we live in this world. In today's world, if we would read even just the Gospels, wouldn't our choices become a little bit easier? As the church preserves the truth of the gospel, it exhibits God's way, the kingdom of heaven to the world. And as we keep the truth of the word alive, the light of Christ shines in the tedious darkness of a hurting world, and the darkness cannot overcome it, ever. When you think about the truth in those words, when you think about the truth as being the light to the world, doesn't it make it all that more important that we keep it for ourselves and then share it with the world? That the truth of Christ's words of loving and caring and reaching out to those that need our help, it becomes all that much more important. It's not a truth we keep within only for ourselves. It's a truth that we share. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, as we come before you this day, we ask that you keep our hearts and our minds open to the ways that we can be your truth in a world that desperately needs it. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. And now I'm going to ask my favorite veteran to come up. Where is he? Carmen? Oh, I was going to say, did I lose you already? I invite you all to stand the affirmation and join us in the affirmation of faith. It's one that's called a litany for the nations, and it was used at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. at the celebration of an Independence Day. Almighty God, giver of all things, we thank you for the natural majesty and the beauty of this land. They restore us, though we often destroy them. We thank you for the great resources of this nation. They make us rich, though we often exploit them.
We thank you for the men and women who have made this country strong. They are models for us, though we often fall short of them.
Inspire us.
We thank you for the torch of liberty, which has been lit in this land. It has drawn people from every nation, though we have often hidden from its light.
We thank you for the faith that we've inherited in all its rich variety. It sustains our life, though we've often been faithless again and again. O Lord, our governor, bless the ones of our land, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to other nations of the earth.
To the president and members of the cabinet, to the governors of states, mayors of cities, and to all in administrative authority, grant wisdom and grace in exercise of their duties.
Give grace to your servants, O Lord.
To senators and representatives, and those who make our laws in states, cities, and towns, give courage, wisdom, and foresight to provide for the needs of all our people and to fulfill our obligation in the community of nations.
Give grace to your servants, O Lord. To the judges and officers of our courts, give understanding and integrity that human rights may be safeguarded and justice served. Teach our people to rely on your strength and to accept their responsibilities to their fellow citizens, that they may elect trustworthy ones and make wise decisions for the well-being of our society, that we may serve you faithfully in our generation and honor your holy name. For yours is the kingdom, O Lord.
Help us, O Lord, to finish the good work here begun. Strengthen our efforts to blot out ignorance and prejudice and to abolish poverty and crime.
And hasten the day when all our people, with many voices, in one united chorus, will glorify your holy name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. And at this time, let us bring our offerings before the Lord.
Thank you.
board, so it's okay. We were just testing. So what do you think is truth? What is truth? Not what is truth to you, because we know that some things go on that we don't like, but what is the truth and what are we called to do as disciples of Jesus Christ? And hopefully that's the answer that you have. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of us now and forevermore. Amen.